Hi everyone. In the last video, we covered what a unit cell is and how the crystallographic points, directions and planes are represented in a unit cell. You can find the link for that video in the video description below. In this video, we will focus on the imperfections seen in crystalline solids, and we will talk about the defects that may be observed in crystal structures. But first, let us define what an imperfection is. The crystal structures mentioned in the previous videos are, most of the time, ideal cases. However, in reality, what we see is slightly different. There are many defects in crystalline structures. These defects have significant effects on the chemical, mechanical, electrical, and other properties of materials. To take advantage of this, sometimes we implement defects in a controlled manner to crystal structures for improving the desired properties of a material. The multidimensionality we have mentioned for crystallographic coordinates in the previous video is also true for crystal defects. There are zero-dimensional, one-dimensional, and two-dimensional crystal defects, which are called point, linear, interfacial defects, respectively. Let's start with zero-dimensional crystal defects. Point defects are usually classified as vacancies, self-interstitials, or impurities. Impurities can be interstitial or substitutional, depending on the size of impurity atoms. A crystal having a vacancy, as the name signals, is missing at least one atom from the lattice sites that was supposed to have an atom. Vacancies can be seen in all crystalline materials. Increasing temperature promotes vacancy formation. So, we can say that number of vacancies exponentially increase with the increasing absolute temperature. A self-interstitial defect is simply the opposite of a vacancy. This time, an atom in the crystal lattice gets into an interstitial site, which is an empty space that can accommodate that atom with some lattice distortion. Compared to vacancies, the probability of having a self-interstitial defect is much lower, since it distorts the lattice. So far, we have discussed point defects, which can occur in a material consisting of a single element. However, we can encounter impurities, some of which may lead to the formation of point defects. Accommodation of these foreign elements strongly depend on their size and concentration. Alloys are formed via intentional and controlled addition of another elemental or a compound material under suitable conditions. Steel is a well-known alloy formed by the addition of carbon solute to iron solvent. In addition to steel, copper-nickel alloys, also known as cupronickel alloys, are another common example for solid solutions. Solid solutions can be either interstitial or substitutional. For steel, tiny carbon atoms occupy interstitial sites, forming an interstitial solid solution. On the other hand, if chromium is added to iron instead of carbon, then a substitutional solid solution would be seen, since the chromium atoms are too large to fit into the lattice interstitially. Instead, they replace iron atoms and enter the lattice substitutionally. In order to determine whether a substitutional solid solution would be formed, can be determined using Hume-Rothery rules. Hume-Rothery rules require two atom types to have a difference less than 15% in atomic radii, both elements to have same crystal structure, similar electronegativities, and lastly, a high number of valence electrons. The bismuth-antimony couple is a good example for the application of the Hume-Rothery rules, as they are completely soluble in each other. Both elements have trigonal crystal structure. Their atomic radii difference is less than 15%. They both have 5 valence electrons, and they have similar electronegativities, which enables a wide range of concentration for these two elements to form a substitutional solid solution. Next, we will talk about dislocations for the one-dimensional linear crystal defects. Dislocations are important since the mechanical behaviors and properties of materials strongly depend on the dynamics of their movements. Dislocations occur when some of the atoms are misaligned and cause some lattice disturbance in crystal structure. All crystalline materials possess dislocations. When dislocations in a crystalline material are mobile, such materials can show plastic deformation. On the other hand, if the dislocations are present in a crystalline material but immobile, then those materials do not show any plasticity, but only show elastic deformation. Here in this example, you can see an edge dislocation, where only a half plane of atoms is ended inside the crystal and could not move throughout it. The location where it ended is called a dislocation line. For edge dislocations, the dislocation line is perpendicular to the crystal plane that we see in the figure. This extra half plane of atoms causes some distortion around it. As you can see, above the dislocation line, atoms get closer to each other, and below it, they move further apart. Another type of dislocation is the screw dislocation, in which the top half of the crystal shifts to the side by one atomic distance. Screw dislocations make that section of the crystal look similar to a metal showing shear deformation. The direction and the magnitude of the lattice distortion introduced to the crystal by a dislocation is shown by Berger's vector, and denoted by small case b. When a dislocation line is parallel to the Berger's vector, it is called a screw dislocation, and is called edge dislocation when perpendicular. Before we wrap up this part, keep in mind that the deformation processes of materials strongly depend on the dynamics of the dislocation motions. Next, we will talk about the last group of crystal defects, which are interfacial defects, also known as planar defects, such as external surfaces, grain boundaries, phase boundaries, and twin boundaries. Surfaces of the material where the interface is in contact with the external environment is considered an interfacial defect, since some bonds of the surface atoms are free at the material-environment interface. Therefore, the total surface Gibbs free energy increases as the material-environment's interfacial area increases. Materials under suitable conditions tend to decrease their total surface Gibbs free energy by decreasing their surface-to-volume ratio to increase their structural stability. Another type of interfacial defect is the grain boundaries, which separate the parts of the materials having the same crystal structure but different crystal orientations. Each of these neighboring crystals are called grains. As there is an orientation difference between these crystals, the observed atom mismatch leads to the occurrence of the free bonds at grain boundaries, making grain boundary regions high energy zones. When a material has more than one solid phase, there will be a phase boundary between these phases, since they will have different types of atoms at different positions and orientations. Similar to external surfaces and grain boundaries, phase boundaries will be high energy zones as well, because of the mismatch occurring at the interface. Last interfacial defect that we will be talking about is twin boundaries. Twin boundaries have a mirror-like lattice symmetry, which in principle is similar to the reflection symmetry operation covered in video 1.1. Twin boundaries form when two same-type crystals intergrow, which leads to slight misorientation and highly symmetric interface between them, which is quite close to one crystal being the mirror image of the other. The atoms located on the twin boundary are shared by both crystals. Due to the slight misorientation between these two intergrown grains, twin boundaries are a much lower energy zones compared to the other interfacial defects. Yet, keep in mind that they still have higher energy than the defect-free zones. With interfacial defects covered, we reach the end of this video. This video was the last one where the theory of structural properties of materials are covered. But this does not necessarily mean that we are done with the structures of materials yet. In the next video, we will focus on and cover the phase analysis of a chemically analyzed material via powder X-ray diffraction. Until next time.